All right, we're going to get started here in just a few minutes, so if you can take your seats. Thank you. Okay, so we have a lot of information to share today, so to try to keep on schedule best we can, we're going to go ahead and get started. So aloha, thank you for coming. My name is Kevin Lockette. I'll be your kind of masters of ceremony. I'm a longtime board member and outgoing president, so but thank you for coming. We want to thank Queens Medical Center for hosting this event. We want to thank our community partners and our sponsors, our speakers, panelists, and of course all you for sharing your Saturday morning with us. We just have a few announcements, and we'll get into the program. So just want to talk a little bit about HPA, Hawaii Parkinson's Association. So just real quick, we were founded in 1996. So we've been around for a while. We've kind of changed our face and focus throughout the years. We affiliated with the National Parkinson's Foundation about 5 years ago, and we went back to HPA a year ago. So we're now a standalone Hawaii Parkinson's Association. The benefit of being standalone, the primary benefit is all the resources that we have are applied on the islands. And since we made that switch and conversion to Hawaii Parkinson's Association, we were able to do a lot more work and we had a lot more resources that just stayed here. So just want to share a little bit. So we have 7 support groups here on Oahu, 2 on the Big Island, 1 on Kauai, and 1 on Maui. We founded and we support the YMCA programs. So we have 7 branches right now. The YMCA's host Parkinson's exercise classes 2 times a week. And we'll be adding Mililani, which will be the 8th branch this summer. And we're currently working with YMCA of Hilo to try to get that program going, and we look to have that started actually this month in April. So last year we had nearly 14,000 visits for these programs. Going forward, we'll be adding a caregiver support group. We're going to hold a volunteer training in May, so there's an announcement on our HPA table. We're looking to expand Club Step and facilitating LSVT Big and Loud training, which is a training for speech physical occupational therapists. So we want to try to increase the resources here locally and across all the islands. So I invite you to visit the HPA table. And if you haven't already, invite you to check out our website. It's Parkinson's with an S, parkinsonshawaii.org. And there's a whole lot of information of all the programs that we have going on. And so also there on that homepage, you can sign up for an e-newsletter that goes out approximately every 2 weeks that lets you know what's going on locally and as well as nationally. So before we get into our program, I did want to introduce the people that make things happen here. So I'm going to introduce the board of directors going forward. And if when I call your name, if you could just stand up, I guess, and turn around. So we will start with our incoming president, Jerry Boyster. Vice President Kay Kenizumi. Secretary Stephanie Cook. And our officer for treasurer is Dennis Cidera. Now, the way our bylaws are written, we can have 13 people on the board. And this is the first time that we actually have a full board. Part of this process, we felt strongly that if our mission is to support the Hawaiian Islands, meaning plural, that we needed to have more boots to, on the ground on the different neighbor islands. So our Hawaii Island Hilo representative is Fran Calvert. Hawaiian Island Waimea representative, he's not able to attend today, is Joel Cohen. Our Kauai representative is Jim White. And our Maui representative is unable to attend today, Risa Pasquale. Other general members, Jill Wakabashabi. Sorry, Jill. But we're going to talk more about Jill here in a minute. Charlene Rodriguez. Okay, Charlene's not here today, but we can clap for her. Tiloi Lolotai. Ami Gupta, who will be here later on. Dana Barbetta. Probably pronounced it wrong. And Vanessa Hollinger. So this is your leaders going forward. So thank you so much. Can everybody sit down except for Jill? You have to stay. Every year we like to highlight and honor someone in the community or on the board who has done exceptional things to help support the Parkinson's community in Hawaii. The Lifetime Achievement Award this year goes to Jill. She has been on the board of directors since 2004, so she's played her dues. She's played many, many roles, but you know, one of her biggest legacies is going to be Club Step, which has been a fantastic program that has been going on for a while, and we're expanding that. So, Jerry, if you'd like to present. Say anything or no? No. Okay.
Hold on. I need a break.
I'm just surprised.
I got to break in for a second because we have another surprise. We have a second Lifetime Achievement Award this year. And he just figured it out. Kevin's stepping down as president, but he's still remaining heavily involved in the Hawaii Parkinson Association. He's been on the board since we said 2009. Mm-hmm. First as a board member, then as president for what, 3 or 4 years now. And he was president during the whole National Parkinson Foundation, HPA split and rewickering. And for those who don't know, that has been a huge challenge. A lot of people put a lot of work into it. And Kevin probably put more into it than anybody. He's probably more involved than any president I've seen in a long time. I've got huge shoes to fill. But so we want to give Kevin also a Lifetime Achievement Award for his involvement. And this doesn't mean he's stopping. This just means this is what you get to date. We'll see what we can come up with in the future.
Thank
you. Yeah, no, Jill got it right. It's actually a lifetime commitment.
Lifetime commitment, great. No, thank you. Thank you so much. Wow, unexpected. One more presentation. So part of the mission of Hawaii Parkinson's Association is our mantra is to help people live well with Parkinson's on our islands. And a part of that is also to support research. And so every year we give a percentage of our resources towards research. Last couple years, well, to step back a little bit, we are very blessed and lucky here in Hawaii. We have two organizations who are a part of national clinical trials and run local clinical trials here in Hawaii. So if you're not aware of them, one is Pacific Health Research Education Institute, and the other one is Hawaii Pacific Neuroscience. If you get on our website under resources and research, There is a link to both those organizations, and you can see what opportunities there are for clinical trials. So one obstacle for people to attend trials is sometimes transportation, especially for the Neighbor Island folks. And so this year, HPA decided to apply our research funds for travel grants, which could be used locally for Oahu if there's travel transportation issues, and also for, you know, flights and other logistics. So I'd like to invite both the representatives from Pacific Health Research Education Institute, Dr. Helen Petrovich, and Dr. Allison Preskop from Hawaii Pacific Neuroscience. If you could come up, please. All right. So, hey, we're doing great. We're on schedule. Just a couple logistics before I turn it over to Jerry, who's going to announce our keynote speaker. The resource fair will be going on, so there'll be a break between Dr. Ross's talk and the panel. So I invite you to go upstairs for refreshments. We are still collecting questions for the panel. So if you have a question, the index cards you filled out on your way out to the resource fair, the table on your left, you can put the index cards in that little wooden bowl, and we will get to those questions. So I'd like to bring Jerry back to announce our keynote speaker. Again, thank you for coming. We have just a great, great day for you.
Thanks, Kevin. Recently, I had the opportunity to attend the National Parkinson Policy Forum in Washington, D.C., and meet with some of our congressional delegations. And I wanted to share a couple observations from talking to 200-plus Parkinson's advocates that came in from 43 different states. Hawaii is especially blessed. We have a tremendous amount of, relatively, this is going to sound funny, movement disorder specialists here in Hawaii. There was a lot of states that had none in their cities, big cities, cities that are much larger than Oahu, than Hawaii. And the other thing that was very interesting was how the movement disorder specialists work together in those organizations. And here in Hawaii, our doctors do a very good job of working very closely together, where that is not the case in many of these other cities. Don't ask me why. Maybe it's aloha spirit. Maybe it's the way we do business around here. But we are exceptionally blessed, and I just wanted to share those with you. And a big piece of that, when I talk to people, is I talk about Dr. Ross, because he is one of the leading clinical neurologists west of the Mississippi. I don't say nationwide because I don't know all the guys east of Mississippi. So he's today's distinguished keynote speaker. Dr. Ross is the Associate Chief of Staff for Research and Development and Staff Neurologist at the Veterans Affairs Pacific Islands Healthcare System here in Honolulu. Dr. Ross received his undergraduate degree in biology with honors from Hendricks College in Arkansas and his medical doctorate degree from the University of Arkansas for Medical Sciences. Following medical school, he completed his residency in neurology at Tulane University School of Medicine in New Orleans and a fellowship in behavioral neurology at the University of California, Los Angeles. And I try not to hold that against him because I'm a USC fan, being born not too far from there. He then went up the street and spent a year as a visiting scientist at the Parkinson's Institute in Sunnyvale, California. Following his training and research in California, he moved to Hawaii in 1991 to join the Veterans Administration and do research with the Honolulu Heart Program, the Honolulu Asia Aging Study, based at the Kokini Medical Center. And this is one of the groundbreaking studies that has been done for the Asia Pacific population. His research on this project focused on environmental risk factors for Parkinson's disease and neuropathology of Parkinson's disease. Besides being a clinical neurologist for the VA, he is a clinical professor of neurology and geriatrics at UH's John A. Burns School of Medicine. Dr. Ross has also been involved in clinical trials for symptomatic and potential diseases, modifying therapies for Parkinson's disease, as a principal investigator with VA-affiliated Pacific Health Research and Education Institute for over 15 years. For his body of work, Dr. Ross has won numerous awards in medical education. Ladies and gentlemen, it is a distinct pleasure for me to present Dr. Webb Ross. He's my VA neurologist. He was my trial neurologist when I, after I was diagnosed and got into one of the drug trials. And he's also somebody I'm very proud to call my friend, Dr. Webb Ross.
That was, thank you, Jerry. It's a pleasure to be here today. This is really something. I've been affiliated with the Hawaii Parkinson Association for a long time, and I've attended many of these symposium. I remember when they used to be over at the Ala Moana Hotel, and they've just grown every year, and it's just really been spectacular to see the response. And I want to congratulate Kevin and the board, and thank you for inviting me to be here today. So I'm going to talk a little bit about research and what's happening in research with Parkinson's disease. I don't really have any financial relationships with commercial interests. I do receive grants from the DOD and from the National Institutes of Health, and I get salary from the Veterans Affairs. And I also thankfully receive research support from Hawaii Parkinson's Association. Thank you very, very much. And we receive support from individuals. Some of those individuals are in this room, and I want to express my gratitude to those individuals as well in supporting research in this condition. So this is no April Fool's joke. This is the first day of Parkinson's Awareness Month. And I want to direct your attention to the second bullet here. Continues the Senate continues to support research to find better treatments and eventually a cure for Parkinson's disease. And I find this ironic, considering the fact that our Senate and Congress are now pondering a budget that includes a $1.2 billion cut to the National Institutes of Health, just after giving the National Institutes of Health a big boost a couple of years ago. So whether you're a Democrat or an independent or a Republican, this will have an impact on the research, not only for Parkinson's disease, but all kinds of healthcare conditions. And if you really care about this, please contact our congressional delegation and express your opinion. With that, that's the end of my politicalization here, but I thought it was important to bring that up. So Parkinson's disease is the second most common neurodegenerative disorder in the world, just behind Alzheimer's disease. At any given time, about 1 million people in the United States have Parkinson's disease. There are 50 to 100,000 new cases of Parkinson's disease diagnosed every year. So in our state alone, there are about 3,000 people at any given time with Parkinson's disease, and around 300 newly diagnosed patients with Parkinson's disease every year. One of the things that we still don't entirely understand is that men are much more likely to develop this condition than women. This red line here represents incidence of Parkinson's disease in the Kaiser Permanente population in Northern California. Down here you have the age group. So you can see that Parkinson's disease is associated with increasing age. In other words, the incidence goes up with age. But the blue line here represents women, the red line men. For some reason, men are about 1.5 more times as likely as women to develop Parkinson's disease. So there has been so much going on in terms of research in this condition, and it's really difficult to spend about 40 or 50 minutes here and give you an update of everything. So I've chosen the topics based on research that I've been privileged to be involved here in the state of Hawaii, and topics that I think that are important to you all as patients and caregivers and family members. And that, so I'll be talking about environmental toxicants and Parkinson's disease. I'll be talking about new treatments that are in development and then new technology to monitor Parkinson's disease symptoms. So why are we interested in toxicants and Parkinson's disease? Well, there are several reasons for this. Number one, we still don't know the cause of Parkinson's disease. And any kind of environmental characteristic that we can identify that might contribute to Parkinson's disease may give us clues to the cause and may give us clues to treatments and to prevention strategies. When we identify a toxin in the environment that may lead to Parkinson's disease, it may help us develop animal models for this condition. And we use these animal models to study the physiology of Parkinson's disease and the reaction of these animal models to different medications and different treatment strategies that might have an effect on the disease. They may help us lead to better prevention strategies, and they also lead to changes in healthcare policy that I'm going to talk a little bit more about as I get into the presentation. So just kind of as a recap here, we define Parkinson's disease clinically as having two out of four of these clinical features, and those features are slowness of movement or bradykinesia, rigidity or just resistance to passive range of motion or stiffness, rest tremor, and that's a shaking or a tremor, it's at rest, it goes away with action most of the time, and then postural instability that tends to occur later on in the course of the illness, and that is trouble with balance. There are a lot of different causes of Parkinsonism, that is the syndrome associated with these clinical features, but Parkinson's disease is a particular condition that responds very well to the medication levodopa and usually starts on one side of the body and progresses over time to involve both sides of the body. And when you look at the brain, there are really two characteristics in the brain that lead to a positive diagnosis of Parkinson's disease. And one of these is loss of nerve cells in a part of the brain called the substantia nigra, which is back in the brainstem. And those nerve cells produce the chemical dopamine. And it's dopamine that is missing in Parkinson's disease. By the time someone's diagnosed with Parkinson's disease, they've already lost half of the nerve cells in this part of the brain. And you can see that these nerve cells are pigmented. They have a black pigment called melanin. So here's a brain from somebody that did not have Parkinson's disease, and this is from a brain from an individual that did have Parkinson's disease, and you can see that it's devoid of this melanin pigment here, and though that pigment corresponds to loss of these nerve cells that produce dopamine. And it's the loss of dopamine that is highly correlated with these motor symptoms of Parkinson's disease, the slowness of movement and the rigidity in particular. But there is another pathological characteristic that's really necessary for the diagnosis of Parkinson's disease, and that is the presence of Lewy bodies. And Lewy bodies are little inclusions within these degenerating nerve cells. You can see this is a nerve cell here that produces dopamine. This is the melanin pigment. And then this is the Lewy body here, which is a target-shaped inclusion body that contains a protein called alpha-synuclein. We don't really know what alpha-synuclein does in the body, but we know that in Parkinson's disease, it clumps together and it forms these Lewy bodies. And we think that too much of this synuclein, when it clumps together, we think that it's toxic to the nerve cell, and it's part of the reason for why these nerve cells die. So what are some of the risk factors for Parkinson's disease that have been identified so far? Well, when we think of risk factors, we think of factors that are associated with a higher risk of Parkinson's disease. And then there are also environmental factors that are associated with a lower risk of Parkinson's disease. And so two of the factors that are associated with a higher risk are environmental toxicants. And I'm going to be talking about pesticides and then a solvent called trichloroethylene. And then head injury. For some reason, individuals with head injury have a higher risk of developing Parkinson's disease. And then there are also factors that are associated with a decreased risk of Parkinson's disease. And actually, I'm going to discuss how we've leveraged this knowledge to develop treatments that might actually modify the disease progression in people with Parkinson's disease presently. Whoops. So how did we get interested in pesticides and Parkinson's disease? This is really a fascinating story, and if you're really interested in reading more about it, there's a book called The Case of the Frozen Addicts that tells the entire story, and it's really nicely written. But basically, back in the mid-1980s, there were a couple of neurologists in the San Francisco Bay Area, Jim Tetrit and Bill Langston. And they were friends, and they literally were at a cocktail party, and they realized that they were seeing patients in the emergency rooms that were coming in with what looked like garden variety Parkinson's disease, but instead of coming on over years, it came on over weeks. And the interesting thing about these patients is that they were all drug addicts. So Langston and Tetrit did a lot of detective work, and they actually were able to trace the drugs that these addicts were using back to a single lab. And this was an interesting time in the mid-1980s. If you remember, there were what they call designer drugs that were being literally manufactured in chemists' homes, and they were making heroin-like compounds. But they were strictly legal because they had different groups attached to it that made it not exactly heroin, but it had the same psychoactive qualities as heroin. So literally, these designer drugs were being manufactured in chemists' homes. And one of these chemists was in a hurry, and he skipped some steps. And a contaminant built up in these batches of designer heroin called MPTP. And when that MPTP was injected, it was converted into MPP+, it crossed the blood-brain barrier, it was absorbed into the dopamine neuron in the substantia nigra, and it wiped out that dopamine neuron. That led to decreased levels of dopamine in the brain and a syndrome that was indistinguishable from Parkinson's disease. Well, this really set the world on fire because MPP plus and MPTP structurally look very similar to a commonly used herbicide called paraquat. Not only that, but the mechanism of toxicity was very similar to other insecticides and pesticides in the environment. So this really started a race to try to find out whether or not these toxicants, these pesticides, could be part of the cause of Parkinson's disease. Interestingly enough, that MPP plus was almost marketed as a pesticide in the mid-1950s, but it was not marketed, thankfully, because it was found to be too toxic. So since MPTP was discovered, we've actually learned that there are several of these pesticides that can have toxic effects on the nerve cells in the substantia nigra. And these include paraquat, maneb, a variety of different organochlorine compounds, rotenone, which is known as the organic insecticide, and trichloroethylene. And all of these, when they're injected into laboratory animals, cause behavior that is suggestive of Parkinsonism in that animal. They destroy the pigmented nerve cells in the substantia nigra that produce dopamine. They lead to loss of dopamine in the striatum that leads to those motor symptoms and the motor behaviors associated with Parkinsonism. And some of them even cause Lewy body-like inclusions in those degenerating neurons. So this has led to the development of several animal models. And like I said, we've used these animal models to try to understand the processes that go on behind the nerve cell loss in Parkinson's disease and actually to try to develop new treatments. Some of you may say, well, Parkinson's disease has been around for a long, long time, you know, and these pesticides, they've only been around, you know, for 75 years or so. This is a plant that I learned about when I went on the fourth grade trip to the island of Hawaii when my son was in the fourth grade. He's now 24. But this is the ahuhu plant, or the fish poison plant. And Hawaiians, when they used to have their fish ponds, they would collect this plant, crumble up the leaves and the roots, and spread it over the fish pond to stun the fish. And it turns out that this plant is loaded with rotenone. And you remember I told you that rotenone was one of those insecticides that actually is used now as a model for Parkinson's disease. So as Jerry said, I came to Hawaii in 1991 to work on a long-term study called the Honolulu Heart Program. And this study began actually in 1965. And the original interest was in heart disease and stroke. And it was comprised of a group of Japanese-American men living on the island of Oahu that were all born between 1900 and 1919. And the first exam was in 1965. And in 1965, information was collected on healthcare habits like cigarette smoking. There was dietary information. There was information on cardiovascular disease, and information on occupation and occupational and lifetime exposure to pesticides. So when I came here to be involved in the study, the focus of the study shifted from heart disease and stroke to dementia, Alzheimer's disease, and Parkinson's disease. So we began to look at risk factors for Parkinson's disease in this cohort of the Honolulu Heart Program. And one of the things that was assessed were years that a person worked on a plantation, and then years of exposure to pesticides, either through occupation or home exposure, and this was assessed in 1971. So all of this information was assessed early on in 1965 and 1971. In 1991, my colleagues and I identified all of the individuals in the cohort that had Parkinson's disease. And we found 160 new cases of Parkinson's disease. So then we went back and we looked to see, we compared the frequency of Parkinson's disease among those who were never exposed to pesticides, and those who were exposed for 1 year or less, or 1 to 3 years, and those who were exposed greater than 3 years. And what you can see from this graph here is that the highest number of individuals diagnosed with Parkinson's disease occurred in those that were exposed to pesticides more than 3 years. It was nearly twice that of the individuals that were never exposed or only exposed a year or so. So this provided sort of circumstantial evidence that pesticides, the general category, might have something to do with causing Parkinson's disease. So this got us interested in looking a little bit more closely at specific compounds that were used in Hawaii, in our state, back during the time that the men who were participating in this study would have been exposed. And we came upon organochlorines. Why organochlorines? Well, for one thing, we know that organochlorines can be toxic to dopamine-producing nerve cells in cell cultures. There, at the time, there had been a few very small studies that found organochlorines to be more frequent in the brains of Parkinson's disease patients compared to non-Parkinson's disease individuals. And we knew that organochlorines, particularly chlordane and heptachlor and DDT, were used widely in the 1940s, after World War II, here in our state, to control termites. And they were also used to control insects on the pineapple plantations until they were banned in the mid-1980s. And then the other key characteristic that allowed us to study organochlorines is that these things hang around in the environment forever. They hardly ever go away. If we went out to the lake in Wahiwa right now and we tried to measure organochlorines, we could still pick up traces of organochlorines in the fish in that lake. So we were able to, you can actually measure the amounts of these organochlorines. So one of the other characteristics of our study, the Honolulu Heart Program, was that in 1991, we began to collect autopsies on as many of the cohort deaths as we possibly could. And we looked very carefully at the brains of these deceased individuals. And we did very standardized evaluations, looking at the brain and then looking at the brain microscopically. And one of the things that the pathologists did was they looked at all of these brains and they identified all of the brains that had Lewy bodies. And you remember I told you that Lewy bodies are one of the key neuropathological components that allow us to make a positive diagnosis of Parkinson's disease. But interestingly enough, while everybody with Parkinson's disease has Lewy bodies, not everybody that has Lewy bodies has Parkinson's disease. So there are individuals that die, they have Lewy bodies in their brain, and we think that some of these individuals anyway, had they lived long enough, they may have eventually developed Parkinson's disease. So we call these incidental Lewy bodies. So for this project, what we did is we identified everyone that had Lewy bodies in their brain. And then we went back and we took pieces of frozen brain and we measured the levels of organochlorine in that frozen brain. And we looked at the association of presence of these organochlorines with presence of the Lewy bodies. And what we found were that there were three organochlorines that were significantly associated with presence of these Lewy bodies. And these were heptachlor, hexachlorobenzene, and achlordane. And you remember I told you that achlordane and heptachlor were highly used in Hawaii after World War II for termites and on the pineapple fields. So this got us thinking about an earlier paper that we had published back in 2005. And this earlier paper had some results that we just really weren't quite sure how to make sense of. And this paper was looking at milk consumption and risk of Parkinson's disease. The consumption of milk was measured in the cohort back in 1965 when we obtained dietary information on the men that were participating. And so we were able to look at milk drinking in midlife with risk of Parkinson's disease in late life. And what we found is that the individuals who drank more than 16 ounces of milk per day, their risk of developing Parkinson's disease was 2.5 times that of individuals who didn't drink any milk or drank up to 1 to 8 ounces of milk per day. And we just really weren't sure how to make sense of this finding. But actually, since this paper was published, there have been at least 7 studies that have shown that the risk of Parkinson's disease is about 45% higher on average in high milk consumers. So why is milk drinking associated with high risk of Parkinson's disease? Well, we know, I'll take you back again to the mid-1980s, this time in our own state, in the state of Hawaii, and many of you may remember this. There was a big news story when the organochlorine heptachlor was found in the milk supply, and it turned out that that milk cows on the island were being fed pineapple refuge that had been treated with heptachlor. And so when the cows ate the pineapple refuge, they absorbed the heptachlor, and then the heptachlor then turned up in the milk supply. The other characteristic of heptachlor and these organochlorines is that we know now that they can bioaccumulate in milk, and so we wondered if maybe it was the organochlorines in the milk supply that was contributing to the high risk of Parkinson's disease among those people who drank high amounts of milk. So this led us to another project, going back again to the Honolulu Heart Program, Honolulu Asia Aging Study, that was based at Kuakini Medical Center. This time, we looked at milk intake again, the same milk categories. But this time, instead of looking at clinical Parkinson's disease, we looked at numbers of nerve cells in the substantia nigra that produce dopamine. Our pathologist was able to go through and take single sections through that substantia nigra and count every nerve cell in that section that produced dopamine and then calculate the density of that nerve cell. So on the left side, is from the brain of an individual that did not have Parkinson's disease. Each one of these dots represents a nerve cell that produces that produced dopamine. And then on the right side of the screen is from the brain of an individual that had Parkinson's disease during life. And I think you can see that the number of these dots is much less in the individual that had Parkinson's disease compared to the individual that did not. When you look at large numbers of individuals, though, there are decreased numbers of nerve cells, even in individuals that don't have Parkinson's disease. So we wanted to see if milk consumption was associated with lower numbers of nerve cells. And here's what we found. So among the individuals that drank no milk, they had the highest number of nerve cells in the substantia nigra. And then if you looked at the individuals that drank more than 16 ounces, they had the lowest number of nerve cells in the substantia nigra. And even when we took out everyone that had Parkinson's disease, this effect was still present. So it seemed like milk consumption had something to do with nerve cell loss in the substantia nigra among these nerve cells that produced dopamine. So milk intake seemed to be associated with dopamine nerve cell loss in the substantia nigra. So then what we did was we looked at, went back to our pathology and our brain organochlorine levels, and we looked at the organochlorine levels in that high milk consuming group, those individuals that drank more than 16 ounces, and compared it to the milk drinkers in the lowest group, those that drank no milk. And what we found that was that heptachlor was present in 9 out of 10 brains in the high milk consuming category, 90% in the high milk consuming category, compared to only 63% in those that didn't drink any milk. Again, suggesting that heptachlor may have something to do with the nerve cell loss in Parkinson's disease. Turning now to another toxicant, trichloroethylene. This is a solvent that's commonly used for dry cleaning and degreasing. It used to be in commonly in household products like carpet cleaners and paints. It's now found in the air and soil and food and human breast milk and up to 30% of U.S. Drinking water supplies. And I'll just say that it has been found in the water supplies in some parts of our island, but in very, very small amounts that do not meet the standard, the EPA standard for toxicity. There were several sort of anecdotal reports of exposures to this solvent with a higher with Parkinson's disease. And so a friend of mine at the Parkinson's Institute in Sunnyvale, California, Dr. Sam Goldman, was able to do a study with a World War II veteran twin cohort. And what he did is he had 99 twin pairs that were discordant for Parkinson's disease. And by that I mean one twin had Parkinson's disease and one twin did not have Parkinson's disease. So then he went and he obtained lifetime exposure assessments of trichloroethylene from occupations or from hobbies, and these were determined from face-to-face interviews with these World War II veteran twins. And what he found was that the twin with Parkinson's disease was 6 times more likely to have been exposed to trichloroethylene, suggesting that trichloroethylene has something to do with Parkinson's disease. And this has been since been replicated in other studies. So why does this make a difference? Well, as I told you, it helps us to understand potentially the cause, but it can also lead to strategies that might prevent Parkinson's disease. And this study comes from the Agricultural Health Study. This is a very large study of pesticide applicators in the state of North Carolina and Iowa. And investigators went through and they did, signed up participants who were farmers and pesticide applicators in those states, and they did very detailed assessments of their exposure to many, many different kinds of pesticides. And the National Cancer Institute was the original funder, but then investigators from the National Neural, from the actually from the Parkinson's Institute in Sunnyvale, were able to piggyback onto this study, and they identified everybody in these cohorts that had Parkinson's disease, and they were able to go back and look to see what exposures were associated with the higher risk of Parkinson's disease. And they found, like many others, that paraquat, rotenone, and certain organochlorines were associated with a higher risk of Parkinson's disease. But importantly, what they also did is they went back and they looked at the use of protective clothing and the use of gloves to see if that modified the risk. And what they found was very interesting, I think. Consistent glove and hygiene use were associated with a reduced chance of having Parkinson's disease in this agricultural health study. And those who had inconsistent use of glove and hygiene habits when handling pesticides still had a high risk. So this tells us, when we have to use these chemicals, use protective clothing. How has this information been used to change healthcare policy? Well, this is Secretary Eric Shinseki. He was Secretary of the VA during the early years of the Obama administration. He was a Kauai boy. He took this evidence that I've been giving you, and for him and the VA, it was enough to add Parkinson's disease to the list of illnesses that were presumed to have been caused by Agent Orange. And you remember Agent Orange was a toxic defoliant used in Vietnam during the Vietnam War. Agent Orange is a mixture of two organochlorine compounds, 2,4-D and 2,4,5-T, and there's a contaminant in 2,4,5-T that also seems to have toxic effects called dioxin. What about trichloroethylene? Well, it turns out that there are water sources that were contaminated with trichloroethylene at Camp Lejeune in North Carolina, the Marine base, from 1953 to 1987. And Secretary Bob McDonald, who was most recently the VA secretary in the Obama administration, he took the science that I showed you a little while ago and decided to propose presumption of service connection for Parkinson's disease for veterans who served at Camp Lejeune for 30 days or more from 1953 to 1987. So this just gives you an example of how this knowledge can actually inform us and change healthcare policy. So I'm going to move now to a discussion of treatment. This, I think, is a really exciting area right now, and if you want to know more about it, you just go to clinicaltrials.gov, and they have a listing of all the clinical trials that there are. There are 139 trials when I looked this up the other day. And, of course, a clinical trial is studying, is treating an outcome. And in Parkinson's disease, there are many different outcomes. There are, of course, motor symptoms of Parkinson's disease. There are non-motor symptoms of Parkinson's disease. There are motor fluctuations in Parkinson's disease, like on-off effects and dyskinesias. There are non-motor symptoms like constipation and memory problems and anxiety, psychosis and fatigue. There are medications that are hopefully designed to slow the progression of Parkinson's disease and protect those nerve cells that produce dopamine. And then there are a lot of exciting trials now in the area of improving measurement of Parkinson's disease symptoms. So what are some of the interventions that are being studied? Well, obviously there are medications, exercise and nutrition. Are being studied as treatments for some of these outcomes, stem cell therapy and gene therapy, deep brain stimulation, transcranial magnetic stimulation, and then some of this technology, smartphone technology, wearable sensors, and telehealth technology to monitor patients' symptoms, and then also complementary and alternative therapies for some of these outcomes that I mentioned. So obviously I can't cover all of these, but I'm going to cover a few that I think are exciting and some of which we've been privileged to participate here in Hawaii. So we're all familiar with the symptomatic medications for Parkinson's disease. It's all really based on replenishing in some way the dopamine that's lost, and we know that levodopa, and when it's absorbed in the brain, it's absorbed into that dopamine nerve cell and converted into dopamine directly. And there are many formulations for levodopa now, including an intestinal gel that's delivered via a pump that goes into the stomach. We have dopamine agonists that act like dopamine. We have medications that boost dopamine, like entacapone. And then we have monoamine oxidase inhibitors that also have good symptomatic effects. It may actually slow down the progression, like rasagiline and selegiline. And then obviously we have surgical therapies like deep brain stimulation that have revolutionized, really, the symptomatic treatment of Parkinson's disease. I want to mention briefly just one medication that's really a new medication. That's the first new medication that's come around for Parkinson's disease in the last 10 years. And the reason I want to mention is it just was approved by the FDA a couple of weeks ago, March 21st. And it's another monoamine oxidase B inhibitor like selegiline and rasagiline. And it's indicated as add-on therapy when somebody's already taking Parkinson's disease medications like Sinemet, and they're in the mid to late stages of Parkinson's disease, and they're having motor fluctuations and on-off effects. Safinamide will hopefully smooth out some of those on-off effects. It's been shown to be well-tolerated and safe. The main side effect are mild dyskinesias in patients. I haven't used this medication yet, but it's going to be available. And hopefully it'll be add to our ability to control motor fluctuations better. I really want to focus on treatments that are being developed to modify or slow down the progression of Parkinson's disease. And there are medications that are being used for this. Exercise may be something that will slow down the progression of Parkinson's disease. And then novel therapies like gene therapy and stem cell therapy. So first are the disappointments. And in science, there are always disappointments. You try to take them in stride, but I take these all very personally, and it's a huge disappointment for me, and I know it's a huge disappointment for you all when a lot of money and your time and your effort are spent, you know, taking these medications and hoping that they have some effect. And sometimes they just absolutely don't. And the ones that have been disappointing are coenzyme Q10, which is a mitochondria booster. And we know that people with Parkinson's disease, their mitochondria, which are the power plants of the cell, aren't working properly. So this was a really hopeful medication, and it just didn't pan out. Creatine, we were a site for the large creatine study. There were over 50 sites in North America that were testing this antioxidant as a potential treatment for slowing down the progression. The trial was stopped early because of ineffectiveness. And then pioglitazone, which is a treatment that's already approved for diabetes. It also has anti-inflammatory effects. And this was another trial that just was not successful. Hawaii was also a site. I alluded a little while ago to risk factors that are associated with a decreased risk of Parkinson's disease. And this is important because we can leverage this knowledge to develop new treatments that might have a beneficial effect. One of the ones that we don't like to boast about or talk about too much is the association of smoking with a decreased risk of Parkinson's disease. And this has been known for over 20 years. And it's been very it's been consistent across different nations, across different ages, in different study designs. We can't get away from it. There's something about cigarette smoking that seems to decrease the risk for people developing Parkinson's disease. Coffee drinking, similarly, is associated with a decreased risk for Parkinson's disease. And physical activity, the more physical activity someone participates in midlife, the lower their risk for developing Parkinson's disease. And then finally, high uric acid. And most of you are probably familiar with high uric acid because high uric acid is associated with a really painful arthritic condition called gout. You know, it affects the big toe, and it is really painful. But not everybody who has high uric acid gets gout. And it turns out that the higher the uric acid, the lower the risk for developing Parkinson's disease. So how have we used this information to develop new treatments? Well, there's a trial that was just completed not too long ago that was looking at transdermal nicotine. And you remember, transdermal nicotine is already approved for smoking cessation. And because of this, a strong association of cigarette smoking with reduced risk for Parkinson's disease, the organizers of this trial thought that perhaps the nicotine patch might slow down the progression of Parkinson's disease. So they first looked at it in these animal models that I referred to earlier, and they found indeed that nicotine and the nicotine patch seemed to protect those dopamine nerve cells. So this trial was just finished. We were a site in Honolulu, the Pacific Health Research and Education Institute and the VA. Some of you were participants in this trial. The trial just completed. We had collaborators all over North America and in Germany, and I'm hope I'll be able to give you results soon, and I'm hoping the results will be positive. There's another trial of a medication called isradipine. Isradipine is a blood pressure medication. It is what we call a calcium channel blocker, and the interesting thing about calcium channels is that they help cells to function normally, and in particular, these cells in the substantia nigra, these dopamine-producing cells, use calcium channels and sodium channels. And here you can see these are all these are molecules of calcium. They come in through this channel, and the calcium channel blocker can actually block this channel and block the influx of calcium. And the reason that's important is that calcium can be toxic to the cell. It can generate free radicals that can actually injure the cell. So by blocking these sodium channels, we convert the cell to use more, blocking the calcium channels, we convert the cell to using more sodium channels. And by that, we hope we protect the cell. There have been epidemiologic studies that have shown decreased risk of Parkinson's disease among people who take these calcium channel blockers. And there was an earlier trial that just looked at safety and tolerability of isradipine in people with Parkinson's disease that showed that it was well tolerated. So now we hope that we have the definitive trial that will show that isradipine will actually slow down the progression of Parkinson's disease. The goal in this trial is to evaluate the ability of isradipine to slow progression in patients with Parkinson's disease over 3 years of follow-up. And this is, again, a multi-center trial, 56 sites, sites participating in the Parkinson's study group. We've enrolled 336 individuals with early Parkinson's disease not requiring dopaminergic therapy. And a recruitment is complete. The trial will be completed in about 18 months. And again, I hope to give you good news later on. The other trial that I want to talk about is a trial that is looking at elevating uric acid levels in individuals with Parkinson's disease to try to slow down the progression of Parkinson's disease. And you remember I told you that uric acid, high levels, is associated with low risk of Parkinson's. We know that uric acid in the blood is a potent antioxidant, and antioxidants are molecules that actually go after oxidant or free radicals that are destructive to cells and rid the body of those cells. So they're a major defense against oxidative stress. We know that low blood uric acid is associated with a higher risk of Parkinson's disease, and actually it's been shown to be associated with a faster progression of Parkinson's disease. And in animal models of Parkinson's disease, it seems to protect these dopamine-producing nerve cells. So will increasing blood uric acid levels in people with Parkinson's disease actually slow progression? And that has led to a clinical trial, a randomized double-blind placebo-controlled trial of urate-elevating inosine to slow the clinical decline in Parkinson's disease. And inosine is the medication being studied. It's a nutritional supplement that raises uric acid levels in the body. And the goal is to determine whether or not this oral inosine, by raising uric acid in the body, may slow down the progression of Parkinson's disease over the 2 years of the trial. This is a multi-center trial, 60 sites. Unfortunately, we're not a site because one of the outcomes in this trial has to do with a special kind of brain scan called DAT scans. And at the time of this trial, DAT imaging was not available in Hawaii. But they are now enrolling, and they hope to enroll 270 individuals with early Parkinson's disease, not requiring dopamine therapy and enrollment. Okay, now I'm going to move to an even newer medication, even earlier in the stage. And here's the headline. Leukemia drug, nilotinib, can cure Parkinson's, Alzheimer's, and dementia as well. Okay, that's a pretty big boast, folks. And I hope that as I discuss this medication, you understand why, when I looked at this headline, I was really puzzled and a little bit disappointed in the hype. Because when we read this in the newspaper, we get very hopeful. So I'm going to just kind of lay this story out and tell you where we are with it right now. Well, nilotinib is a drug that's already approved for leukemia. It's a chemotherapeutic drug. It activates cells that clear out unwanted proteins, and at high doses, it kills cancer cells, and it seems to make brain cells healthier at low doses. It also tends to clear out the abnormal toxic protein associated with Parkinson's disease. Remember synuclein that's in those Lewy bodies that we think when it clumps up in the Lewy bodies may be toxic to the cell. And the nilotinib seems to get rid of this synuclein. So based on this information, researchers at Georgetown University instituted a pilot study. What's a pilot study? It's an early study that looks at feasibility of a certain intervention for a certain condition. It's an early, early trial. They wanted to see if nilotinib was safe in Parkinson's disease patients, and they wanted to see if it got into the brain. So they enrolled 12 subjects with Parkinson's disease. 11 completed the trial. Everyone received the drug. There was no placebo arm, meaning there was no inactive drug that was comparing, being compared to the active medication. And they found, indeed, that levels of synuclein, the toxic protein, were decreased in the blood and in the spinal fluid. They found that Parkinson's disease symptoms, including tremor and freezing, actually improved, and in some individuals improved dramatically. And cognition even improved in some of the 11 subjects that completed the trial. The subjects tended to use fewer Parkinson's disease medications, and it seemed to be safe at low doses. But what are the limitations? You cannot base these results on 11 subjects that were all on the drug. The investigator knew they were on the drug. The subject knew they were on the drug. There was no placebo control, and we know that the placebo benefit in clinical trials, particularly with Parkinson's disease, is very, very strong. A placebo is an inactive medication. And all the trials that I've talked to you about up till now have had a placebo arm, and both the investigator and the patient have been shielded from knowledge regarding whether they take the active medication or the placebo. And in this way, we can make an objective assessment of whether or not this medication is having the desired outcome. So this was intended to be a trial that was looking at feasibility and tolerability. And indeed, it found the medication to be tolerated. But it did not prove effectiveness. The drug is very expensive, $10,000 a month. And when this drug was taken away, when the individual stopped taking the drug, their symptoms returned. So this was in no way a cure, as that headline announced. But based on this short-term study of 11 subjects, more than 200 people worldwide, and we really don't know what the true number is, are taking this medication for Parkinson's disease. And we know that this medication is associated with severe side effects, including sudden cardiac death and bone marrow suppression. And I just want to take just a moment to say that, you know, the progress in the transformation of science to clinical medicine really depends on diminishing harm and increasing effectiveness, right? So we're not there yet with this medication, and I know that these wheels seem like they grind slowly, and they do. And I know that the FDA sometimes tends to seem to want to sit on some of these kinds of therapies, and they do, but it's for good reason. And I just think that we were a little bit premature in our enthusiasm for this medication. However, there is a new clinical trial. Georgetown University, the same investigators, have started this trial. They began randomization and enrollment in January of this year. It's called a randomized, double-blind, placebo-controlled study to evaluate the impact of low doses of nilotinib treatment on safety, tolerability, and biomarkers in Parkinson's disease. So again, this is not even the definitive trial. This is the next stage. This is the placebo-controlled phase to see, again, if it's tolerated and safe, and if what dose might be the most effective dose. So this drug is in the works, but it's not there yet. Unfortunately, I don't have time to talk about some of the future therapies that I think will be promising. These include stem cell therapy. You remember, stem cells are these cells that have the potential to develop into any kind of cells. And they can actually be programmed into cells that produce dopamine or programmed into cells that produce chemicals that encourage growth of nerve cells. And then they can be injected into the brain and hopefully turn into cells that become manufacturing plants for dopamine or proteins that encourage nerve growth. There have been a lot of animal trials. When I was at the World Parkinson Congress last September in Portland, there was a lot of information going on about stem cell trials and a lot of caution. And there are a lot of investigators that don't feel like we're quite ready for trials in humans yet. But there is at least one trial of pluripotent stem cells going on in Australia right now. There are a lot of commercial places around the world where you can get stem cell therapy, and you have to pay great sums of money. If you have to pay money for an experimental form of treatment, please be cautious, because all of the research that I've been telling you about up to now is research that's done with no cost to the participant in the research. There shouldn't be any cost, because we're trying to figure out if the medication works and if it's safe. So a lot of these stem cell clinics are giving stem cells based on very shaky proof of concept. And some of you may have read not too long ago, there's a coverage of an article that was published in the New England Journal of Medicine of three individuals who were undergoing stem cell treatment for eye problems, and they went blind. So this was for macular degeneration. So please be cautious, and I would suggest that any stem cell therapy that you participate in now be part of an approved trial, and there aren't any right now in the United States. I think gene therapy is another very promising form of therapy. And in gene therapy, a gene is inserted into a vector, usually a virus. And you can think of the virus as an envelope. So that gene goes in there. That gene is programmed to produce a certain protein, or for example, it might be a precursor to dopamine. It might become a dopamine-producing cell. That virus then is injected into the brain of the patient. Hopefully, it goes to the cells and where that gene can be turned on and turn on a plant that will produce whatever the chemical is that's being injected, whether it's a precursor to dopamine or whether it's a protein that might encourage nerve cell growth. And there are trials going on with this now, and I think this is a very exciting area of therapy. And then finally, monoclonal antibodies. And remember, antibodies are part of our immune system. Our body produces antibodies to fight infection and fight inflammation. We can manufacture antibodies in the lab. And monoclonal antibodies are antibodies that are produced from a single cell that go to a specific part of cells that we're interested in treating. And there are monoclonal antibodies now that actually go to nerve cells and help to clear those nerve cells of the synuclein, that toxic protein that's built up in people with Parkinson's disease. And there's been one trial now that has looked at, actually it's been in about a dozen healthy people, not people with Parkinson's disease, just volunteers, where they've used this monoclonal antibody to see if it gets if it lowers levels of synuclein. And indeed, it has resulted in lower levels of synuclein. So now they'll be moving to the next stage. So the last thing that I want to talk about in the last 3 or 4 minutes here is the use of technology to help with monitoring symptoms of Parkinson's disease and help us in our self-management of Parkinson's disease. As you all know, there's no objective marker of Parkinson's disease progression. We monitor progression by examinations. And so we all have to have training when we do these trials so that we examine patients as closely as we can to a standardized practice. But there's always variation, so we're constantly looking for markers that give us objective ways of tracking the symptoms and signs of Parkinson's disease. We all know that the management of Parkinson's is complex and the side effects are very complex. And this is the one that we all are very aware of. A 30-minute visit to your neurologist 3 or 4 times a year is not adequate to address all of your symptoms, all of your signs, all of your problems with the medications and the side effects. And we need some way of self-management, some way of getting data on what you're experiencing and get that to your providers so that you can work together to come up with a good form of treatment. So can smartphones be used to maybe improve symptom monitoring, medication adherence, and self-monitoring, self-management? So there have been several of these, and I just sort of picked a couple out of the blue that seemed interesting to me. And in this study, this is a customized phone cell app that uses a voice test, a posture test on the person's phone, a gait test where they walk 20 feet and it's timed, a tapping test where they tap on the phone and the speed is measured, and then a reaction time test that is a measure of cognitive function. Then they collect all this data and they analyze it, and what they found in this one small pilot study is that this information can actually differentiate individuals who have Parkinson's disease from individuals who do not have Parkinson's. So it may be helpful in a diagnostic way. And it also predicted the severity of Parkinson's disease that was measured by, you know, the gold standard by examinations. Here's another one. Investigators from the United Kingdom found that the use of a Parkinson's disease smartphone app was associated with improved treatment adherence. It helped patients take their medications and monitor their medications, and it helped the patients, it improved their perception of their collaborative relationship with their treatment provider. And the interesting thing about this app is that you can download it today. Unfortunately, you can't use it because it's only been used in clinical trials. But it's from U-Motif, and you can go to the website. But I've actually been assured by this company that this app is going to be available to the public in the near future. Right now, it's at invitation only, and it's only been used by in trials, but I'll just show you a few of the features. This is the page of the app that is the medication tracker and reminder. This is the page that monitors symptoms, and each one of these petals here in this little flower is a different symptom. So there's movement and stiffness and energy, mood, pain, sleep, and exercise, and you can move these petals in or out depending on, you know, the degree of the symptom that you're having. And then all this information is collected as data, and it's made into a report that's shown with how these symptoms are progressing over time. And you can use this report yourself, or this data can be taken to your provider, and you can work together to try to improve the control of your Parkinson's. This is just the one of the games on the app that is a finger tapping test. You tap A and B, and then the timing is monitored. So that I hope that some of your questions, I know you have a lot more questions about this, and our panel, I hope, can address some of those. But I think there are many, many things that we can all do now, And I think it's really important that you work with your healthcare providers to be knowledgeable about Parkinson's disease, to be adherent to the management plan, but be flexible, because if there's one thing that's certain about Parkinson's disease, it's going to progress. And just because a treatment plan or a treatment regimen works really well right now, it doesn't mean it's going to work the same in 6 months. So you have to be open to change. One of the quotes that I want to give you from the conference that I was at in Portland, the World Parkinson Conference last fall, is fatigue and stress are the enemy. And unfortunately, we don't have good treatments yet for fatigue, and we all have stress. So rest is really important here. When you feel yourself getting stressed out, when you feel that fatigue, rest and meditate. Do something to recharge your body. Eat well. We had a great talk last year on nutrition in Parkinson's disease, and there's a lot of good information on nutrition. Exercise. We've seen a lot of examples of exercise upstairs, and it doesn't really matter what kind of exercise you do. Participate in a support group. You're all doing that now because you're all here. And consider participation in research when you can do that. And along those lines, I just want to show you a couple of trials that are available now. They're still enrolling. This is at Hawaii Pacific Neuroscience. Dr. Borman is associated with Hawaii Pacific Neuroscience. And they have a couple of trials ongoing now, and some of you may be eligible for this. This is the phone number up here, 564-6113. One of these is a medication that's kind of a caffeine-like medication that we hope will treat the motor fluctuations of Parkinson's disease. And another one, droxidopa, is a medication that we hope will manage the dizziness associated with Parkinson's disease, the low blood pressure that we sometimes get when we stand up quickly. So these are some great resources. The Fox Foundation just released a toolkit for individuals with Parkinson's disease in honor of April being Parkinson Awareness Month. So I'd encourage you to go to the Michael J. Fox Foundation website, download that toolkit, and use it freely. Of course, the Hawaii Parkinson Association website. And there's one that I just found that I think is really spectacular if you're really interested in the science of Parkinson's disease. It's called The Science of Parkinson's Disease, and it's a website right here if you're interested in that. That's all I have. Thank you so much for your attention. I'm a little bit over, but I appreciate your patience.
Thank you again. That was an excellent presentation. Before we do a short break, is Amber in the room here? Can we get Amber and Melanie? I neglected to, when I was introducing the board, two individuals that are, they're not on the board, but they've been working with us with our walk, and who's also helps us with our website, social media, and is you. Probably have communicated with Amber. She is our program manager, so I wanted to. And then Melanie Moore. Melanie has been, and Amber works for Melanie, so we contract from Kakua Communications for these services, and it's one of the best decisions that we've ever made on the board. And then Melanie is our walk coordinator. So we did our first walk. We could not have done, was it 4 years ago now? We could not have done it without Melanie, because we had no idea what we were getting into. And she's been fantastic and continue to partner with us this year and ongoing in the future. So I just wanted to introduce, because these are guys you're going to be interacting with, maybe via email and definitely with the walk. So thank you guys. So we're going to take a short break. We're doing pretty good on time. Dr. Ross was fantastic with watching his time, so I didn't have to give him the evil eye, but did a great job. So we could take about a 15-20 minute break, use the restroom. I would invite you to go up and visit the resource fair. We will make an announcement when we're starting the panel, so you won't miss anything. If you have panel questions, please drop them off. It's outside the door to your left. There's a little wood bowl. Put your questions in there. Just one quick comment on the questions. We had 24 questions submitted on our online form, plus what we collect today. So we are going to try to get through as many as we can. If we do not get through all the questions, although Dr. Ross answered about five of them already, but if we don't get to them, we are going to post them online. So it'll be on our website so you can get a response to that. Also, today's conference is videotaped, as well as we'll get the slides available online too. So if you know folks who couldn't attend, give us a little bit of time after the conference. We will have that up on our website, and you could watch it on a YouTube link. So, all right, so we'll reconvene in about 15, 20 minutes. We will give you a warning if you're not here, and we won't start without you. Okay, thank you.